So welcome everybody to this session where we will build upon the first session about immune aberrances and MDS to talk about how to modulate the immune system in the treatment of MDS. I will be chairing this session together with Professor Garcia Manero. My name is Andreas Osko and I'm here from Copenhagen. And I also have the pleasure to introduce Siliamo as the first speaker of this session. Siliamo Garcia Manero is from the MD Anderson Cancer Center, and he will give a talk about the combination of hypomethylating agents and immune checkpoint inhibitors.
Thank you, Andreas, and it's a great honor to be here in Copenhagen. So these are my disclosures. So I was asked to talk about this topic of thinking about incorporating these immune checkpoint inhibitors in our practice in myelodysplastic syndrome. So the first question is, why would you think about this concept in this disease? So I think between yesterday and today, you have heard that there is quite a bit of data from different centers indicating that there is a strong evidence that innate immunity and other inflammatory type of signals are really relevant in this disease. And this is data from our group where we have developed a multi-platform omic structure looking at what happens before and after hypomethylating agent-based therapy. And this is a snapshot of one of these RNA-seq experiments. And what you see and you have heard before is that indeed, actually, these signals are there. So based on this concept and data actually from Steve Baylin at Johns Hopkins a few years ago in solid tumors, we decided to study if this pathway of PD-1, PD-L1, 2, CTLA-4 was expressed in patients with myelodysplastic syndrome. So this is a relatively old paper from our group, but it's the basis of different studies, not at MD Anderson only, but across the United States at least, where we, in a very simple set of experiments, showed clearly that these molecules are overexpressed in patients with myelodysplastic syndrome. And what is interesting, actually, that this is not in the outside the myeloid compartment. You actually see this both in CD34 and peripheral blood mononuclear cells. And it's basically for all these different molecules. The question is this relevant also at the protein level? So we developed a number of flow immunohistochemistry type of assays. So there is clear evidence that this is also present at the protein level in the bone marrows of these patients. And what I think is more important, and I think this slide from the paper is very relevant, is that you see this in patients, and you can actually measure this sequentially in our patients. Of course, you could do this by flow cytometry or any other assay. But I think what we're showing here is that when you treat a patient with a hypomethylating agent, then you basically see a peak on the expression of these molecules a few days after therapy. Why I think this is important is because it perhaps suggests some form of sequencing these hypomethylating agents with these immune checkpoint inhibitors. And indeed, actually, this is the schema that we have used in the studies that I'm going to show you in a couple of minutes. I'm actually proud of that paper because at the beginning, people were kind of curious, why would you like to use this kind of drugs in this disease? And now this is from a paper Dr. Daber published in Leukemia a few months ago, showing basically a list of different clinical trials where this is being explored. Now, I don't have time to go through all these trials in the next 50 minutes. So basically, I'm going to tell you a little bit of our experience at MD Anderson with these compounds. So the first study that we were able to develop was a study that was multi-center trial with pembrolizumab in patients with a high-risk MDS that were what we call hypomethylating agent failure, most of these patients high-risk disease. This data was presented at ASH a couple of years ago. We're trying to push Merck to allow us to basically write a manuscript with this experience. And the response rate, as the prior speaker from UK was telling us, was that the activity is very low. So the response rate with this single agent PD inhibitor was basically less than 5%. But there's a very important signal, is that a couple of patients that are still followed in my clinic actually are still alive 5-6 years later with high-risk HMA failure. I mean, I think you could say this is an artifact, but I think biologically this is very interesting because potentially those patients may be cured or they should have died a long time ago. So the response rate may be long, but in short, but in some of these individuals, actually, you may have long survival. Of course, we would like to know who are those individuals. So based on that trial and the prior data through an alliance that MD Anderson has with BMS, we decided to develop a big basket trial trying to incorporate different molecules in combinations with these hypomethylating agents in different subsets of patients with myelodysplastic syndrome. This was just presented at ASH a few months ago. And basically the criteria for this is in this slide, basically patients with MDS, and we had two different cohorts, people that had not received any prior therapy and patients that had HMA failure disease. We're a little bit careful trying to exclude patients that may have already active inflammatory or autoimmune conditions where perhaps the use of these immune checkpoint inhibitors may be potentially toxic, patients with active hepatitis or HIV disease. And then we use what I think is a standard concept in terms of what is considered to be a hypomethylating agent failure. And what we did here was basically to develop this into small cohorts with an idea of then, say, go, no, go for different interventions. So basically, as you see in the table, on the left, you have the HMA failure cohorts. Here, what we did was to introduce first monotherapy with immune checkpoint inhibitor. So we have cohort one, that is the single agent nivolumab, followed by EP, and then a cohort three with the doublet of nivo plus EP. And then the previously untreated groups, I think will be kind of questionable whether you will just use monotherapy in this group of patients, particularly because they have high-risk disease. So we started doing combinations of ASA-NIVO, ASA-EP, and then the triplet. And here, you know, we have some stopping rules. This is a classic design we've used many times with 20 patients. And then depending on the signal here, we will decide to take this forward into larger studies or not. So basically, an issue that I don't have an answer that is shown here is what actually the right dose of these compounds. At the end, I'm going to give you a little bit of what we plan to do in Houston. We use these doses of 3 mg/kg. I can tell you that this could be okay for monotherapy. For sure, it's way too toxic if you want to combine these drugs together. In terms of the patient characteristics that were treated here, I think this is important. These were people with very high risk features. So this is basically their chromosomal profile. Very few of these patients were diploid. What I think actually is important is here, is that when we do our standard genomic profiling, you know, you see that the number one gene mutated in this cohort of patients was P53. So these are patients with adverse cytogenetic and molecular features, both in the frontline and in the relapse setting. So let's start first with the response rate. The prior speaker had a very nice slide showing a very small or low response rate with monotherapy. So that's very important because I think that's consistent with the data that we saw with single agent Pembro. So when we look, for instance, at the response rates of the doublets with azacitidine, what you see here actually is that the response rate may be potentially higher than what you will expect with single agent hypomethylating agent. So in the cohort of ASA and NIVO in the frontline, the overall response rate was around 70%. For those patients with ASA and EP was around 60%. And then consistent with the prior speaker, we saw actually very few patients having any significant response in the HMA failure context to either single agent nivolumab or ipilimumab. So we think actually that there is a clear synergism in terms of response rate with you combine this with these hypomethylating agents. But I think what is really interesting, and again, these are 20 patients, but the follow-up now is quite long, it's actually close to 2 years, is that we're starting to see a difference in terms of the survival of these patients. So this is the overall survival for patients in the front line treated with a doublet of azacitidine with NIVO or azacitidine with EP. And what you see there, that very interesting curve on top, that is the red one with ASA and EP, where perhaps the complete remission rate, if you paid attention to the prior slide, was not as high as ASA and EVO, but these patients actually are now alive without a median survival with a follow-up of over 20 months. We have never had data like this in our hands with any of the prior doublets that we have investigated. So again, 20 patients, long follow-up, but it needs to be a further study, of course, in larger cohorts and randomized trial. When we look at those patients that had HMA failure, of course, the expectation here is significantly less, or it should be. But actually, these numbers with monotherapy in patients without a response actually are potentially higher than what you will expect in a similar cohort of patients that are not treated or treated with a second-line type of investigational compound, with a median survival, both with EP and NIVO, of a little bit of over 8 months. So that's actually potentially an interesting signal there in terms of the survival of these patients. Now, one thing that I want to make sure is that, yeah, we see responses. We see in this small trial that there may be durability of those responses that are actually translating to survival. But I don't think this is ready for off-protocol kind of a standard of care just because you have these drugs in your practice. Why? Because it's actually quite significant toxicities. And this may not be actually toxicities that you may or may not familiar in your practice. If you do a lot of CAR T-cell type of therapies or transplantation, yeah, that's easy. But if you are more in a community clinic without a lot of support, this can get a little bit complicated. So this is some of the toxicity profiles that we reported in the meeting. The main one actually that is the most concerning that we saw more frequently is actually pneumonitis. And of course you see these patients and then the question is, are these patients having a fungal pneumonia or some type of pneumonia or this pneumonitis, should I give steroids or not? So the message is that if you're gonna use this type of compounds, we tend to be extremely aggressive using steroids and not trying to see if the patient has or not an infection, because we saw very rapid improvement if you do this type of therapies in our patients. Now, I don't have time to go into a lot of the biomarkers. This is done actually through the immune therapy platform at MD Anderson that is led by Dr. Jim Allison. But we're trying to actually explore who actually may or may not be responding to this kind of therapy. Right now, we don't have any data suggesting that any particular mutational profile, let's say those patients with P53 that may have more neoantigens, respond more or less to this kind of therapies. But we're starting to do some cellular studies. So there may be some correlation between the level of expression of PD-1 or PD-L1 or 2. Simona Colla in our group is starting to see actually if there is an impact in terms of hematopoiesis in these patients. So in those patients that respond, we actually have seen cytogenetic molecular responses and actually shifts in abnormal patterns of hematopoiesis that we're ready to report in some of these trials. And then there may be actually upregulation of concomitant targets. So for instance, if you treat with a PD-1 inhibitor, you may see upregulation of a CTLA-4 type of gene expression signature and the reverse. Of course, you see there the data with TIM-3, and there is now a number of clinical trials actually combining this with other PD-1 inhibitors, also in combination with azacitidine, but we don't really have any major data as of yet there. Why is this data important? Is because if you see this kind of regulatory type of mechanism, perhaps you could think about these triplets where you combine azacitidine with, let's say, a PD-1 inhibitor and a CTLA-4 inhibitor. So we've done that. This is just to remind me, this was a poster attached also last year, but what I can tell you is that at the doses that we were using here with the 3 mg/kg of the Nivo and Ipi, this is really toxic. Now it's actually powerful. So we have documented very nice molecular responses in these patients with P53 mutated disease, but at the cost of very high toxicity. So this cohort now is on hold, and we're actually adjusting the doses, particularly of the ipilimumab, to really see if we can deliver this kind of therapies. Because if we can, then perhaps actually this may be even better in terms of outcomes. And this is now being adjusted, and the study is actually ongoing here in Houston. Now, we also then explored some data with pembrolizumab, so in combination with ASA. And you're going to see actually here that the response rate and the signals that we have seen in terms of durability of responses, in my opinion, may not be as robust as what we saw with the Nivo and the IP. So this was also presented at ASH by our group a few months ago. Here again, this kind of gonna-go type of design. We have a cohort of patients with previously untreated, patients with relapse refractory disease. Here, what perhaps is a little bit more novel is that we actually did not discontinue the hypomethylating agent in those patients that were HMA failure, as opposed to what we did with the Nivo-EP trial. One thing that I didn't mention when I started with the pembro is that actually this has a very nice safety and toxicity profile compared to what you see with EP or nivolumab in different in the similar group of patients. Now, also, it looks like this a little bit less active, and actually you wonder if this drug is really adding to the hypomethylating agent or no. So this is basically the response rate that we reported. Again, the follow-up was shorter than what we had for the Nivo and Ipi. Complete response rate may be in the untreated cohort of 17%. This doesn't seem to be higher than what you will expect with the single-agent hypomethylating agent. Interestingly, actually, there were some responses in this combination also in the HMA failure cohort. And then in terms of the long-term survival, again, follow-up is short. But it doesn't seem to be that this is actually anything better than what you'll expect with single agent hypomethylating agent. Now, Again, the issue with the compounds, and this, I don't know if this is related to the type of agent or how this is designed, but it's toxicity. So Dr. Gertz from the Cleveland Clinic was very kind to give me his slides from his presentation at ASH with a different molecule in this class, that is this PD-L1 inhibitor called atezolizumab. And unfortunately, actually, this was, I think, a negative study, and it was not negative because of the activity that they presented, actually because of the severity of the adverse event. So this is the design of this multicenter phase one trial with different cohorts and different doses. But my understanding, actually, is that this study basically had to stop, or it was stopped early, because of excess toxicity with this particular compound. Now, we don't have experience at MD Anderson with this particular drug, but again, the signal here is that these are drugs that probably still need to be studied under very controlled situations. So this is my last slide. I think what I showed you is that this is possible to incorporate these kind of compounds in the treatment of MDS. This is obvious. We are curious, actually, about the single agent activity of ipilimumab, and I didn't go through that in a lot of detail in the HMA failure. This is a proof of concept because I think that the data in terms of the survival that we have seen with ASA-IP is actually of great interest to us. And I have to disclose actually that when we were designing this clinical trial, we almost did not open the IP arm because this is considered kind of like a first generation immune checkpoint inhibitor. And in solid tumors, I don't think this is a drug that is very commonly used, and it has a different toxicity profile than these PD-1 inhibitors. Yet, in these myeloid malignancies, we're seeing actually very nice response rate and potential survival. So right now we're actually expanding in the frontline this cohort of ASA ipilimumab in those patients. Now you have high response rate with ASA and Evo, but we've done in the past many times through many of these doublets. So again, this will have to be studied in larger studies. As I mentioned earlier, I think that it will be very critical to develop these combinations using both a PD-1 and a CTLA-4 inhibitor. There are actually a number of BiTEs that are being developed that block both molecules at the same time. But again, the toxicity of that type of approach is significantly higher. As I mentioned earlier, this is not ready for prime time in community. The main issue is going to be the toxicities. Most of these problematic ones are related to lung toxicity, but you may see other toxicities that may occur in a cohort with an N1 of 1, mainly neurotoxicities and things like that, that may be quite concerning. Are all these drugs the same? Absolutely not. You saw the data with the atezo that had to stop earlier. Then you have the toxicity profile with pembrolizumab that actually is quite benign, but perhaps with a lower response rate. And I think basically, I think this is a combination that needs to explore both in the frontline and in the relapse setting. We need more studies. We need to have larger cohorts and eventually some type of randomized study to really confirm the value or not of this type of combinations. And with that, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to present our data. This is actually a collective effort through the MD Anderson, both in the leukemia department and the immune platform at MD Anderson. And I will be happy to have any questions. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Thanks, Guillermo. That was very nice. We at Yale participated in some pharma sponsored studies. One is a randomized trial, I believe, Azo with or minus Pembro, if I'm not mistaken. We had a guadacitabine and a atezo study. And we agree that the limiting thing for many patients is pulmonary infiltrates, which we try to treat like fungal infections. And when it's getting worse, decide, well, it's potentially immune related. And because of the nature of the patients, you can't get biopsies, even if you were to bronchoscope patients. So end up giving steroids, and we had no deaths. But at least on the pharma-sponsored studies, once you were given steroids for potential pneumonitis, you were not allowed to give them further exposure to the immune checkpoint inhibitors. So in your study, when you had pneumonitis, were you able to resume the Pembro or the Nevo? Because without that, most of our patients ended up getting really only one cycle of the combination. Right. Very few people, and we've treated, over a dozen, I would say, very few patients we're able to get more than one cycle.
I love this question. First of all, Dr. Seydan in Dr. Gore's group, when he was at Hopkins, published the first paper with EP in myelodysplastic syndrome. Actually, it was attached many years ago, and nobody knew why you guys were doing that. So that was very important.
We didn't either.
But you know, now we know. But that was a very important paper. But what Dr. Gore is saying is actually fundamental. And I'm sure there's a lot of pharma people, and that's very important. But sometimes the studies are designed in kind of awkward ways. So I totally agree with what Dr. Gore is saying. We don't see reason why you will take off someone that you gave steroids because you think the patient is having pneumonitis. Indeed, actually, we do the reverse. If we see a patient, and of course, I didn't talk about the AML data. This was just published in Cancer Discovery a few months ago. So we've probably treated like around 500 patients with this type of combinations, both in MDS and AML. And the data in AML also is quite interesting. If we have a patient that is in one of these trials and presents with some type of either quote-unquote weird clinical symptom or clear evidence, we actually automatically start these patients on steroids. So we don't really rule out whether they have. We'll treat them with antifungals, antibacterial, plus the steroids. So we don't wait. And actually, in the last version of this trial, we have incorporated some kind of transplant modality with effective anti-T-cell type of therapies, like some type of cytoxin or things like that, to block this type of signal. But Steve is totally correct. In our opinions, unless the toxicity is really overwhelming and you will fear re-exposing the patient to this type of therapy, you should continue. Absolutely. So if they have a little bit of an infiltrate with pneumonia, you need to continue to expose these patients. So that's a very important message.
Well, then your studies may really reveal things that the corporate-sponsored randomized trials will not be able to, because we'll have to see the data. And you know, I think it depends on how bold the people were to not call things pneumonitis, because once you call them pneumonitis, people stop getting treated for most of these studies.
That's very important.
Thanks. More questions?
Thank you very much.